Now, with that, let's rope ourselves into a special telecast on a series that we've been doing for the past more than a month. We are calling it the Second Wave's Superheroes. We are trying to recognize individual organizations for their selfless service during what was a very difficult time for all of us in the country. Our first guest is actor and social activist Arushi Nishank, followed by the principal of Manav Studies School, Deepthi Bhatnagarji, and our third guest is Prerna Sinha. She's a student of Miranda House, and last but not least, Wajid Ali, member of VNR Social Services. Listen in.
Arushi Nishank helmed projects for COVID-19 relief efforts across Uttarakhand. Arushi and her team, Sparsh Ganga, sent ration and medical kits in Haridwar and beyond. They even started helpline number for beds and other facilities. Since the start of the first wave, Arushi and her team have been relentlessly distributing masks and sanitizer kits to people. NewsX proudly recognizes second wave superhero Arushi Nishank and her team.
Hello, welcome. I'm Uday Pratap Singh. You're joining us on NewsX on our special segment, Second Wave Superheroes. We have joining us today a special guest, actor, producer, and social activist Arushi Nishank is live with us. Arushi, welcome to NewsX. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you so very much, Uday.
You've been doing, of course, some great work in this very tough time. So let's begin by just talking a bit about that work, Arushi. Tell us a bit about what you, your NGO, have done in this very difficult time.
I would say this was a very, very crucial time, and we're still not completely out of it. We all have seen the first wave, and second wave was more dangerous, if I would say. And we all have lost, you know, a few near and dear ones. What we could do in our small capacity, we tried to do that. And from Sparsh Ganga NGO, which started in 2008, in the last wave also, we distributed many khadi masks. Mm-hmm. And because I always talk about environment issues, so that was very important for me, that whatever we are making should be, you know, taking care of the nature as well. So that was a reason that we created khadi mask, which can be, you know, dissolved into earth once you finish using them.
Yes.
And in this time, because Uttarakhand was a state which is, you know, largely hit by this wave.
Yeah.
And because we all were rushing back to the hills, you know, we feel that that is the safest place in this time. And maybe that would be one of the reasons that, you know, simple people of Uttarakhand from the interiors of these Uttarakhand valleys,
yeah,
you know, got a major, major hit. And that is why we send a lot of ration for the people. We have sent oximeters. We have sent oxygen concentrator for them. I know it wasn't in a very big number which can, you know, fulfill all the requirements and demand. But again, you know, this is a time we all can show that we are human. And this is a fight to save humanity. So, this is a very small thing. Through Sparsh Ganga, and the whole team has provided a number also, a helpline number, where we were trying to help people who do not have access to beds, who do not have access to oxygen, and such a small things we are trying to do.
No, great. And what made you do this? You know, was it just the fact that you were hearing some very troubling stories, some troubling reports, seeing those scary pictures, you know, also, as you said, Uttarakhand was very badly affected, the home state where you come from. So what made you, you know, get so involved this time around?
There always been, whenever you get into any social activity, actually, there's not a single reason you jumped into helping people, because you feel from core of your heart that you really need to do something in this time. Mm-hmm. And because I come from Uttarakhand and I have seen people there, they're the toughest people, you know, and if you see the death rates were really trolling up. And that really scares all of us, because I know there are a lot of people in Uttarakhand don't even know that what sanitizer can do. You know, they're the simple people.
Yeah.
For wearing their mask, it's like, why we have to do this? We are the strongest people.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of education and that awareness was also required.
Yeah.
And certainly, because again, I would say I've seen people suffering, you know, very close to me from this disease, and that was very important. That really pushed us that not only Uttarakhand, we have started doing some work in Delhi also. Yeah. And wherever our Sparsha Ganga team are available, we just, you know, trying to keep our people safe, because we need to be at home. We also need to take care of us and then to other people. So we just tried a little bit.
Do you plan to continue this work in the months and years ahead as well? Of course, you're getting more and more busy professionally. You're getting more work in the film industry. But do you plan to continue this work as well, you know, side by side?
Uday, I have always been very busy, because I don't know how many people know that I'm a Kathak exponent. I take care of a few business setup also. And I am an actor and actor producer also. But, you know, there is something when you need a recognition from the society and from the people, they have given you. They have given you immense love. So this is a time, you know, when your people need you, you should, you know, keep everything aside and you should come forward to help them, to help the society. And I make sure that main kitni bhi busy kyun na hu, I will make sure that I'm taking some time out to help people, to motivate this new generation is my major agenda. And
I was going to ask you that. Do you believe that's the message you want to give out, that people must come forward? You know, in times like this, government has their role, but people also have their role, you know, to come forward and help in this time. Is that the message?
I always say this, and I always believe that, you know, we cannot keep blaming our government for each and everything. You know, sometimes we also have to take a responsibility. We have to take a charge. And this is what I have done whole of my life. I have never been, you know, dependent on somebody and, you know, just looking forward for some external support. Mm-hmm. First, we need to start from ourselves. You know, the charity begins at home. We all know that. So this is a very important thing. Yeah, certainly I agree with you that we all have to do our bit.
Okay. Well, keep doing your bit and wish you all the very best in the years ahead. Thank you so much, Arushi Nishant, for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Uday. Take care.
For heroes, we have Mrs. Dipti A. Bhatnagar, principal of Manavsthali School, which launched a student's initiative to help people procure COVID-19 resources. Welcome to the show, ma'am.
Hello, good evening, everyone.
Can you tell our viewers about the students' helpline launched by Manavsthali School and how the student council was formed to help people in such a distressing time?
Yes. So basically, I should start with a saying that my chairperson always used to say, Dr. V.K. Bhatnagar. He always told us that we educationists are the nation builders, are the world builders. So end of the day, I think it was a world pandemic, and it was time that each one of us should have taken action.
Yes.
And our director, ma'am, Mrs. Mamta V. Bhatnagar, she always encourages us, and she's always guided us to do something for the community. And that's what our name of the school stands for, Manav Stali. So Manav Builders. You know, we can have doctors, engineers, but end of the day, we should have good humans who can understand their duty towards the society, towards the community. And that was the thought behind it. It was a need of the hour. And so we formed Manav Suraksha, which was a 24/7 helpline. We started it at end of April, and it very actively worked for a month. And I'm glad that we don't get many calls now. We already have a student council formed in our school every year, which is of 11th and 12th students. And we have Anushasit Senani, which are again a set of students who we try and inculcate leadership qualities and everything. So they are from the 9th and 10th. So together, we formed a team of 80 students, where some set of students were working as the core team, like Kuvum Sethi, Mohe, Priyanka, there were many. I mean, I wish I could name all of them. And what they were doing was they were collecting data on a real-time basis, because what we realized were people were panicking when they were down with corona. They were not able to get beds in the hospitals. They were not able to get medicines on time. They were not able to get ambulances to drive them to hospital. So what our team did was they were trying to contact and call various areas, from ambulances to hospitals, to chemists, to people who can come and do x-rays at home, people who could, we could book an appointment for actual CT scan where COVID patients were treated. on a real-time basis. So every day it used to happen so that there are no fake numbers, there are no lost leads in the process. And we were sharing that with anyone who was calling us. And then there was a set of PR team, which is basically students who were actually talking to the patients who were calling us for help. We were just trying to help. So we were practically getting 800 calls a day initially, which is...
You know, coming to this, you know, what are the challenges faced by you as a school principal when this young students as well were going through a lot of distressing time and, you know, to set this entire helpline up and encourage them that it's okay, it's 800 calls a day, we can push it further. So what was your challenge as a school principal?
Frankly, I think there was nothing. I think our students, by grace of our director, ma'am, I think she's inculcated in all of us from the very beginning that we need to give it to the community. And I just had to say that, come on, let's do something. Let's give it back. It's time, whoever is well, we must come upfront. I think the only challenge we were facing was, we didn't want it to float students' personal numbers, publicly on, such a big scale, because end of the day, you do get certain fake calls and the numbers can get floated and wrong information in wrong hands. So yes, we had to procure a corporate number, which was with lockdown, a very, very difficult task. But then again, some of our ex-students helped us to, get that in time and then float them. The second issue we were facing was, yes, even though we were doing a real-time check, but end of the day, we couldn't take the guarantee. Our students were calling and they would say that, yes, we have oxygen cylinder, and we would verify for 2-3 things. But then end of the day, we did face certain times that, certain people were not genuine. And that was something which demotivated our students. And, we would have daily meetings. I would also like to actually mention, the daily meetings were not done by me. It was done by my team of my teachers. Miss Mukta, Miss Sonia, and Miss Vandana, they were very, very on the feet every time available to those students. And I would have a weekly meeting while those teachers are having daily meetings. So yes, that was one issue. So students would get demotivated. Then, ma'am, what do we do? We want to help this person. And the only way out was that, we can do our bit. And that's we have to draw a line somewhere. We also had to tell students not to get emotionally attached. I still remember a case which went on for 2-3 days. There was an old lady, she had no one. So she was just panicking. She just kept saying, get me police. And she had no test done. So, it was very difficult to calm her down and for our students not to get emotionally involved. So every time the teachers and I had to counsel them that don't get emotionally attached. Such work has to be done with a very practical frame of mind. Yes, the whole initiative was started on emotional front to do something for the society. But end of the day, you have to be practical when you're doing such jobs. So I think, that was one challenge, kids getting emotional. But then we have a school counselor who, would talk to students and tell them that it's okay. We are doing our bit. So yes, that was
Thank you, Mrs. Dipti, for sharing the experiences. Really appreciate the service for the nation you did during such distressing time. Thank you.
When India's healthcare system was decimated by increasing COVID infections, Prerna and her friends from Miranda House stepped up to help those in need. They made a website under COVID Aid India to provide verified leads pertaining to oxygen and other life-saving medicines. Prerna addressed over 100 SOS calls an hour and worked round the clock to help people in need. NewsX proudly recognizes second wave superhero Prerna Sinha and her team.
Joining me today is one such student who has been helping out people amidst all this chaos. Prerna Sinha, she's a final year philosophy student from Miranda House, Delhi University. Thank you so much, Prerna, for joining us today.
Thank you, Deeksha.
Well, let me begin with asking, about the Miranda Desk COVID helpline, which you have been part of, where you were volunteering. What exactly is it? And, tell us about it.
Okay, so if I tell you my personal experience and how things started, so basically, very much around the COVID situation worsened in Delhi. There were people who were asking for information, any sort of information that they have regarding hospital admissions, availability of oxygen. Now, as a student and as a person, actually, I've never heard of a thing. I've never come across shortage of oxygen. Like, these are certain kind of things that you're supposed to, like, you're mentally prepared for people to run out of beds or injections, but oxygen. So we've always had this in mind that oxygen is something that the hospital is automatically going to provide you with. But then people started running short of it. And there were leads, there were huge messages of information, there were a lot of links which were being forwarded all over social media. They were there, our class groups were flooded with them. Some people were posting stories regarding how they need certain resources, and the other people were posting stories regarding how can they provide certain resources. But then what happened, there's a huge gap in between a person who's asking for the resource and the supplier, and that gap had to be bridged. Now the problem here is that anybody who is in a situation of crisis, for example, the patient's family, friends, whoever are in charge of the situation, you cannot expect them to go ahead and verify each and every contact that's been passed on to them. And because they are already in a situation where they can't afford to lose time, or they don't even have the mental capacity to do it after a certain point, because this is something that I realized after one single day, that it takes a mental toll on you. So one of my classmates, who is also my batchmate, we're in the same department, she came up with this idea that let's do something, because all of us have been working on a personal level. What if we like accumulate all our efforts, come up as a team, and then, you know, we divide sections, we divide departments, and we start looking into particular resources and put them in certain columns. So that is how we came up with the whole idea of MH Helpdesk. And it's the name has MH because it was initially started by the students of Miranda, but then other people also joined in, and it's been teamwork, I would say, and no certain person or a certain group of people, even the people who started it, they cannot be completely credited with the kind of things that we are. Yeah.
Prina, tell us about, you know, what all challenges did you face when you were working for the, you know, Gwalior volunteership? You know, what all challenges did you face? Because Delhi, we know. Tell us about what exactly was happening in Gwalior.
So I think my experience about Delhi and Gwalior, they're both very interconnected. And okay, Miranda helpline, like the MH help desk, was working specifically for Delhi NCR for a certain period of time. Although we are trying to, because we are getting leads from all over the country, so we are trying to verify as much as possible. But then the spreadsheet that we are creating, which is there in the bio, and which I must have sent you as well, that spreadsheet contains information that will apply only at the Delhi NCR level. And we were receiving calls from all around Delhi, and like within a span of 15 minutes, I would receive around 100 phone calls. And the sad part about receiving phone calls, when every phone call, every query sort of phone call that I used to attend, it used to be around a minute, because I had to explain them the next procedure that they're supposed to shift to, contacting the suppliers who were verified by us, etc. So during one single conversation, I used to miss around 4 or 5 calls. So the situation was very bad. And then this is one thing that I realized, because I'm not a student, like I do not belong to Delhi. I'm not a resident of Delhi NCR. So I used to feel guilty regarding the fact that I have information regarding Delhi. I'm constantly posting about Delhi, but I don't know anything about Gwalior. And in that moment, it used to make us feel guilty, like all the outstation students especially. So then we started working at the local level as well. So there were a couple of there were more than a couple of seniors from school in Gwalior that I started working with, and they were helping me out. I was asking them for leads. They were asking for leads in return, all of those things. One problem that I faced was, now Gwalior particularly is a city which is very much near Delhi. So the resources that we were supposed to, like the resources which were supposed to come to Gwalior, before coming to Gwalior, they used to go back to, like they used to get like booked by people in Delhi. So there was a certain compartmentalization of resources in that particular manner, because people who could afford, they didn't really remain in Gwalior as well. So they went ahead to other cities for their treatment.
Well, thank you so much, Prerna, for your selfless service for saving our fellow countrymen.
VNR Social Services and NGO and food distribution team helped families source ration and medicines during the pandemic. The team, led by young individuals, provided 15 days ration and sourced COVID-19 medicines free of cost to the poor. NewsX proudly recognizes second wave superhero Wajid Ali and his team.
Can you tell our viewers something about yourself and the organization and how you have been helping people, particularly during the second wave of COVID-19 pandemic?
So myself, Wazir Ali, I'm a member of VNR Social Services. By profession, I'm a child psychologist and a part-time theater artist. So basically, the VNR is a computer training institute, which is led by one of my friends, Rajendra Ram Singh. So, which is situated in Pallia Kalan, district of Lakhimpur Khiri, Uttar Pradesh. It's nearby Nepal border. So first we started food distribution of food packets in our hometown. So when we come across some people who need some raw material and raw groceries, so we thought, let's try this also, like if we can arrange some grocery for the people who needs it. So then we start making some packets, including some rice and some wheat flour and onion, potatoes, cooking oils, and these kinds of stuff. So we made packets, and then we started distributing those raw material as well.
Right. Can you tell us about the challenges and obstacles faced by you and the team personally, and also, you know, in terms of funding and operations?
So like whenever you are starting a social service and these kind of stuff, so the most challenging thing is like finance. So we were also dealing with this challenge. So like when we thought, like, let's start something for the society, so the most biggest challenge in front of us was the finance. So we thought everyone is in this difficult time is dealing with the financial issues. So like how people will come to us and donate for this such kind of thing. So then we thought, okay, let's start with our savings. Then if we will start publishing our things, like we are doing this something for the society and we are doing something for the people of the city, so maybe some people will come and will get some donation. And this happened also, like when we started posting that we are doing this and we need help from the society, so the from the people of our city and across the country came up, and then they started donating, and so we started getting the donations, and then we started like continue our work. So it's been 10 days almost now, and we are distributing food packets and raw materials. So, and we also started the medicines, like we were thinking about the distributing medicines. So that was also a big challenge, like how we'll get the medicine and who will like provide the medicines and this time, like. So we started distributing medicines as well right now. And if you will talk about the challenges, other challenges, so if in the this remote area, people are not aware about the COVID appropriate behavior. Whenever we were going out for the helping people in the society, so like we was looking at the people, they are not wearing mask and they are not using hand sanitizer, or not, they are not at all, they are following any protocol which is provided by government. So like whenever we are going out for the help, so like we were also risking our life, like they were not at all following anything, like, and we are wearing mask and everything, we are wearing gloves, mask and whatever we have. So we were trying to protect ourselves as well and spread some awareness, so you guys have to follow these things. But that was in remote areas, the ground reality is totally different. People are not aware, they don't follow any COVID protocol and all.
Thank you so much, Mr. Wajid, for joining us on the show. And thank you for for your service to the nation in such difficult times.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.